What's cracking, big dogs? Welcome back to the channel. As you can see, we got a special guest, one of the original big dogs of the channel. Nicholas is back in the studio. Today, we are going to have another fantasy football episode for y'all. We're going to do a mock draft for 2017. I know this season just ended, but it is never too early to be thinking about fantasy football. That's such a lie. It's so early. Most leagues wrapped up. Unless you're a complete degen and you're doing DFS in the playoffs.
No.
More power to you.
God bless.
You need to...
I took enough heartache.
You need to relax. But anyways, we are back to do a 12-team half point. We'll do half point PPR.
That's what everyone should play.
Half point PPR, mock draft. Only the first round for 2017. Very early. Very early. We know. But
we don't care.
We don't care at all. It's a great season. That's another lie. It's a terrible season
it
for
really
me.
Was.
We have to do a little passing of the guards. If any of you guys followed the league last year, we knew this was the 2015 champion.
I beat the shit out of that thing.
And it's not going to me. I didn't win it either. We have to eventually hand this off. Check this bad boy out. If you're interested in getting one for your league, Fantasy Jocks, linked below in the description.
I was runner-up this year, by the way.
Yeah, he gave it a valiant effort. I'm not going to lie. This feels fucking good. I feel like Stone Cold right now. Like, I got to beat someone's fucking ass.
I used to wear that out to the bars everywhere.
Oh, yeah. He fucking wore this shit in. That's what you got to do as a champion. But I guess I wouldn't know that feeling yet. So we'll put that aside for now. Let's get into some action. Play the music. In a discussion that you'll probably hear all offseason, who to take with the first overall pick? Le'Veon Bell, David Johnson, Le'Veon Bell. For me, I think for both of us,
yes.
I can speak for both of us when I say Le'Veon Bell is my number one pick. Bell's my guy here. Bell obviously missed the first four games of the season last year. Still finished fifth in rushing yards, second in receiving yards. Out of all running backs, he averaged 157 scrimmage yards per game. That's almost as many passing yards per game as guys like Kaepernick, Osweiler, and Fitzpatrick averaged through the fucking air.
Real good QB company.
Yeah.
Nonetheless.
Yeah. So Bell, I think, deciding between Bell and David Johnson, the reason I go Bell here is because you trust the offense more. You trust a guy like Big Ben as opposed to Carson Palmer, who seems like he's on the decline. You know, if Palmer struggles next year, you could see David Johnson getting the high volume, but seeing a decrease in efficiency. So Bell's my guy here. He's basically like having an RB1 in your lineup along with the wide receiver 3 in one slot. So number one, my boy, your boy, everyone's fucking boy, Le'Veon Bell.
Consensus. And if he's not smoking dope, look for him to play 16 games. So with number two, as Nick said, was David Johnson. The only concern I was going to touch on is Carson Palmer, and he can't be trusted. So David Johnson might see stacked boxes, but it doesn't really matter. The guy's an absolute animal. If he didn't get hurt in the last game, he would have had over 100 yards from scrimmage each game. That's ridiculous. And he had 20 fucking touchdowns.
Yeah.
I mean, what more do you want? 20
it's
fucking touchdowns.
It's his first year as a workhorse.
That's
the
first year as a workhorse. That's LaDainian-type, Tomlinson-type numbers.
I know, with way more.
Incredible. And he's young. From the backfield, you can trust him in .5 PPR. Full point PPR, standard, everything. The guy's a workhorse. He's only going to continue to be the workhorse.
You think? All right, so he had, what, 2118 yards from scrimmage last year? 2118 yards from scrimmage. Over, under, next year?
I'm going to go over.
Over. Over. I'd agree with you on the yards, the 20 touchdowns.
Yeah, that's tough to
let me set the over, under at 15. What do you say?
I'm going to go over. Total touchdowns?
Total touchdowns, 15.
I'm going to go over. I think he's going to fall between the 15-17 range. I mean,
I don't know. I feel like it's so hard for a player to hit 15 total touchdowns. Like, you have to have everything go right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If he misses 2-3 games for some reason,
you're right.
He probably drops out of that. But
I'm counting on.
I wouldn't put money against him.
Yeah, I'm counting on full 16 games, all the touches. He's just too talented. So. And I drafted him last year. Should have been able to keep him, but I dropped him.
He'll never let that down. Okay, so also
clear cut 1-2.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with you there. He has that injury. He had a sprained MCL. I think it was week 17.
Yes.
Just to touch on that for anyone who's concerned about next year, it's like a 6 to 8 week recovery time.
No surgery.
Yeah, no surgery.
He's good.
Yeah, he'll be fine for next year. which moves us to numero three.
I hate Julio's guts. That's why.
Fuck you hate Julio's.
Well, because he fucking six touchdowns. Actually, I don't want Matt Ryan to win.
Fuck you. You win MVP. You see those odds?
Yeah,
dude. Matt Ryan minus 600 to win MVP.
Whoa.
Oh, wait. We want to take a minute to thank our sponsors, by the way, for this video. Shout out to Crest for the white strips. Appreciate that very much. Also, shout out to Tito's Vodka, the leader in premium vodka. Send more my way if you have any. And lastly, shout out to...
Can't shout Barstool out, right?
Shout out... We can shout Barstool. Oh, shout out Barstool for the ugly Christmas sweaters.
One bite.
We appreciate you sending those over. And Julio Jones, obviously. You didn't sponsor this video, but if you want to be on the next video, we got you. Number three, this is going to be a tough one, also all offseason. And I think the big argument here is probably going to be between Antonio Brown and Ezekiel Elliott.
Pussy.
Can't go wrong either way. Personally, I'm going to go Antonio Brown here with a number three pick. It really doesn't get much safer than that. Back to back to back to back seasons of 1,500 or 1,300 yards, I should say, total yards. He's got double-digit touchdowns for three straight years. I mean, I don't really need to tell you the stats. And he missed the game, too. He still almost hit 1,300 receiving yards, 12 touchdowns. And you saw in the playoff game, he absolutely exploded. So there's plenty more of that to come. And the thing about the receivers and the running backs, the receivers actually had, overall, like the landscape of the NFL. I was looking at some other stats today. Quarterbacks, only five quarterbacks threw for 30 touchdowns this year. Only five. And there was 11 last year that did it.
Going in, you're like, you know, passing me, passing that.
Yeah,
like, that's a shocking number.
Yeah, exactly. And so Antonio Brown still finished as, I think he was PPR number one. Standard number three behind Jordy and Mike Evans, but he's top three. He's number one PPR, I think, 3 years running right now.
That sounds bad.
So you can't beat that. He was second in receptions this year. Now, the thing with Brown is his targets dropped to 150, 154. The last 2 years, he's been at 193, 181, 165. So this was his lowest in 4 years, and I would expect that to inflate back up to his normal numbers, and you could see even bigger, you know, back to his 2015, 2014 type numbers. So I think Brown is arguably the safest pick overall in the draft. Definitely still the number one overall wide receiver consensus.
Defense is going to have to focus on Bell and Brian coming back, and he's going to have a wide open field.
I pray just as a football fan that we finally get to see that Steelers offense like operate
all
as a whole.
In one.
I don't know what the deal with Martavis is.
Yeah, I don't either. I was just assuming he was, but I have no idea.
Yeah, I would have loved to have seen Brown, Bell, Big Ben, fucking Martavis all get to play on the field together.
There's only one defense in the league that can stop that.
Yeah, the Falcons, right?
The Giants. Speaking of the Giants stopping players, the next pick I would have to go with, can you say his name?
I thought you were going to go with Odell.
No.
The Giants.
I'm not going to.
So Nick is going to take a player from his favorite team here, Zeke, double E's, easy E, Ezekiel Elliott from the Dallas Cowgirls.
You could talk.
Watched the video, you would know that I root for the New York Giants.
Sorry, baby.
Elliott, in any format, I'm taking for because I know exactly what I'm going to get. He's going to touch the ball close to 20 times a game. I think 18 he averaged a game, right?
18.
He had 18 touches in every single game. So we had no less than, except one. So we had no less than 18. All right, guy scored 16 touchdowns. He led the league in rushing. Even though he's not too much of a threat out of the backfield, he's 6 yards short of 2,000 scrimmage yards all year. Yeah. So
I think the thing with Zeke is, like, even though he's not getting the receiving work there, like, he's getting so many touches just rushing the ball behind that
volume,
offensive line.
The volume just boosts those yards up, those touchdowns. And, again, behind that offensive line.
Yeah. And I was looking at some of the contract numbers on the O-line. They have...
Are they locked up?
Not every one of them. The only one, I think left their left guard, maybe, was it? I have it written. Yeah. Four of their five offensive linemen are locked up at least through next year. So Zeke's going to have basically the same exact offensive line to run behind.
And if they're not playing the New York Giants, you know that's a pretty damn good offensive line. So he should easily equip the 2,000-yard mark next year.
Yeah, I think...
Good, surefire top five pick. You can't go wrong with him. You know you're going to get every single week. There's no duds. He's always going to produce.
See, the crazy thing about this, it's crazy how fantasy flops back and forth, because if you put Zeke into last year's fantasy draft, I think he'd be like the consensus number one, maybe number two.
Yeah.
You know? But the fact that, like, the running back landscape kind of switched back to, like, clear workhorses. Mm-hmm. You have guys like, I think Le'Veon Bell was averaging over 28 touches a game this year when he was playing, and David Johnson had to have been upwards of like 23, 24.
With that volume, you're going to get points.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Yeah,
especially with their talent.
So he could have easily been, you know, the number one consensus pick in other years.
Yeah.
Number five is where it gets interesting. I have a few names written down here. We're just doing this off the dome because, you know, this is how you do it in drafts. Now, number five.
Tough.
I'm going to side with my boy here, the double sticks. Me and Julio down by the championship game.
Yeah, he didn't show up for my championship game.
So he was wide receiver 4 in fantasy points per game. Obviously playing with Matt Ryan, who had his career year. Gonna lock up that MVP, gonna lock up the greatest quarterback of all time title.
Okay.
You know, we saw Julio kind of do what he's been doing the last couple of years. He didn't hit that touchdown total. He's staying at 6. They just didn't give him the red zone looks, but he's still getting fed target after target after target in one of the most explosive offenses in the entire NFL. One of the things that I love about Julio, especially last year, he was averaging 17 yards per catch, and that's 2 yards higher per catch than he's been averaging over the last, I think it was 5 years or so. So what that means is basically, you know, the Falcons are looking to exploit the deep ball to Julio. They're looking for Matt Ryan to take more shots. And that was a big thing that I think I touched on last year coming into the season, is that they were going to be looking to throw deep to Julio. So, you know, they saw it be very successful for them this year. So why not translate that into next year? And I know a lot of people are probably going to, you know, debate Julio versus Odell versus, you know, whoever this offseason when it comes to picking players in their drafts. The reason I go Julio is the same reason that I go Le'Veon over David Johnson. I trust in the Atlanta offense and Matt Ryan and that offensive line, which progressed tremendously this year over the Giants offense. I mean, that Giants offense has potential, obviously, to have a big game, but they're just not consistent, man. Eli, the GM said it. He's on the back nine, man. He's on the back nine.
No, he's not.
No. How many more years Eli got in him?
5, 6.
I thought you were going to say 15, 16. But I'm going to go, I'll go Julio here at 5.
Yeah, I like Julio. The only thing that worries me about him, obviously, like you said, the touchdowns. Matt Ryan threw to 13 different wide receivers for touchdowns this year.
That's, yeah, they do have a lot of weapons.
Do we smell like onions? Yeah,
I do. I think this is actually a little off on the target scale.
They're not going to fucking critique me on my targets.
Facts.
Okay, with my next pick, I'm taking my guy, number 6 overall, bargain, Odell Beckham. Other than partying on a Miami boat the week of a playoff game and dropping playoff touchdowns and ripping my heart out, you can't beat Odell Beckham in fantasy. He had 100 catches, 1,400 yards, 10 touchdowns again. The guy is back-to-back top 5 fantasy campaigns. He was number 2 in targets.
Back-to-back
for 20 years in a Giant uniform. Excuse me. He was number 3 in receptions, 3 in yards, 5th in touchdowns. The guy's an all-world talent. And like you said before, that Giants offense is just so pedestrian. He is obviously their focal point, and he's going to continue to eat the targets. Last year, he never had a game lower than 7 targets, and his high
That's huge. Because he's a player who could turn...
He could turn a 5... I always said...
Give him 5 targets, he'll turn one of them into a 60-yard touchdown.
He did that on 4 separate occasions this year, and that's pretty much the Giants offense. So they're going to feed him the ball. He is literally their only option. He's going to have, you know, he's got close 10 targets a game. With that volume, he's going to put up numbers. And like you said, at any given point, he's going to break one. Hopefully next year his best year, because that means I'm going back to the playoffs and I'm looking for a 3rd Lombardi trophy. But Odell at 6, steal.
I think what else was interesting as I saw it, he had a 32.3% red zone target share of his team's red zone targets, which is 2nd highest in the entire NFL for wide receivers.
And for a 5'11 receiver like that.
Yeah, so the thing is, like, so many of his touchdowns come on these 60-yard slants that he just turns into touchdowns, but he's also getting those targets in the red zone and in the 10-yard line, so it's not like...
Which is, you know, vastly important, and he's getting the targets everywhere on the field.
If 1 year, targets out for, like, 18 touchdowns, you wouldn't be surprised.
No, and he'll do it.
Yeah, he will. He's so young. What is it, 23?
23, yeah.
Yeah. All right, so we've moved past, what do we have so far? 3 running backs, 3 receivers, right? Yeah. So we're at pick number 7. And this is where it starts to get
dicey.
Dicey. Fucking dice does the fucking around here. I am debating between, you know what, this is totally not me to pick this guy. He's totally out of characteristic for me to go this way, but I'm going to go with Jordy Nelson.
As you hate Jordy.
I don't hate Jordy. Great guy. Great person. But, you know, coming into 2016, I was not big on him. He was coming off that big injury. You know, it's hard to predict that kind of season coming
into it.
Exactly. Like, how are you going to pick a white player in the top 10? Unbelievable. He took a shit on my chest, obviously, when I didn't take him in any of my leagues 2016. Earned the number one fantasy wide receiver ranking throughout the year. And he started off slow, too.
He did. Like he really turned it on later on.
Yeah, his receptions, just the eye test, too. He looked slow, you know? And you're like, I don't know if Jordy's ever going to regain that form. But he certainly did by the time the playoffs rolled around. Now, Jordy had the most targets inside the red zone as well as inside the 10-yard line in the entire NFL. So when you have a guy like Aaron Rodgers feeding you those targets,
the
ceiling is fucking through the roof. And the thing about him being inside the red zone is you have those guys like fucking Allen Robinson, you have those guys like whoever it is that's super athletic, and the quarterbacks just kind of chuck the ball up to them, you know? And I think the reason people are so hesitant on picking Jordy is because they don't see him making those kind of plays. His vertical's not fucking like LeBron James where he's jumping up out of the fucking sky, catching the ball at peak. He's a guy who runs the slants, he runs the inside, the outside, he can run a fade if he needs to, but he doesn't have to rely on just his athleticism. You know, he's so technically sound.
Everything, route running, everything.
Yeah. So, like, if a team wants to go away from the fade, if they want to run something inside, Jordy is still that guy for them. I think he's a super, super, super safe pick as a number one receiver for the best quarterback in football. And a lot of these things could have been said last year. You just didn't know how he was going to perform coming off the injury, obviously. I was listening to a podcast earlier today, the Fantasy Footballers. I don't know if you ever heard them, but if you haven't, check them out. They're a really good podcast. It's three dudes just fucking talking shit all day, but they know their stuff. So Jordy had 11 top 25 finishes. And he finished as a top five wide receiver six separate times, which is, like, insane. If you think about it, a top five at your position.
This man deserves more respect.
You know what I mean? And, like, he was the most consistent. Not only did he put up the highest numbers, but he did it, like, consistently week over week. So you have guys like fucking Brandon Cooks, right, who will finish as, like, a top 12 receiver. But how many times did he finish in the top 25? Probably like four or five, you know what I mean? And
skewed numbers.
Having guys like that on your team, while they can win you one or two weeks throughout the year, probably end up losing you more because you take them so high and they only produce for you a certain number of weeks. So I think when you get a guy like Jordy who finishes inside the top five, inside the top 25 so many times, you know, those are league winning type of guys. So I think Jordy's as safe as it can be. He'll be fine by next year with the ribs. But I mean, whoever I'm picking, you should probably just go the opposite way, considering how last year went.
It's a new year.
I want to tell them how, in case you forgot, my first five picks in our big league last year. Number one, Allen Robinson, snake draft, second round pick, Brandon Marshall, Sammy Watkins, Jeremy Maclin, Jeremy Langford.
Langford, yeah.
Like, those are my first five picks.
That's...
I'm fucking embarrassed. Mm. I'm pathetic.
It didn't work out.
Yeah, we'll just say you'll have a very entertaining video coming your way soon.
Oh, that's right.
Whatever. Fucking go.
Man, all right.
Pick number eight.
I want to be like Mike.
All right. Numero eight, right?
Eighth pick, Mike Evans. Mike Evans was second behind Jordan Nelson as wide receiver this year. He led the league in targets. He's a big motherfucker. He had 97 catches, 1,300 yards, 12 touchdowns. At eight here, wide receiver, what, four, five?
What?
Mike Evans. No. This draft that we took him.
Oh, number eight overall.
Number eight overall, I was saying. He was the...
What are you talking about, ADP last year? I don't know what you're asking me.
I was saying we took...
Oh, how many receivers have we taken already?
I was saying with that production as the wide receiver five, gotcha. I would take that, sign up for it.
Antonio, Julio, Odell, Jordy.
So he'd be wide receiver.
How did we just count that and then forget, right?
No.
I think we got five.
Jordy, Julio, Antonio Brown, Beckham. So yeah, he'd be wide receiver
five off the board, but still within the top 10.
Yes. And with the production he gives me, 100 catches, 1,400 yards, 12 touchdowns, I'm signing that up any day. Doug Martin is suspended for the first three games of next season. And as you saw, Tampa Bay did not really run the ball well. last year without Doug Martin.
It's a fucking understatement of the century.
Come on. So they're going to be throwing the ball all game. And Evans, I don't see why he wouldn't be able to put up the targets that he did this year. Lead the league again. If, you know, top five, worst case.
I can see you in the mirror. It's crazy.
Do not hesitate to draft Mike Evans. Yeah. But for a big year. The guy's a monster.
Yeah, I think this is the year that a lot of people expected him to have last year.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
He's continued to grow. And with Jameis.
Yeah, as they grow together.
He's getting better. The chemistry's there.
Yeah, so the crazy thing that crazy stat that I found when looking into Mike Evans was that, you know, he had 12 touchdowns, and you'll take that any fantasy year. But he wasn't even in the top 15 in terms of red zone targets. And he was the number one targeted receiver in the entire NFL. For him to not be in the top 15 of red zone targets is crazy. So the ceiling for touchdowns will shoot up. You know what I mean? Like, there's so much potential there for him to give him like another 5, 6, 7 jump balls. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, he could hit 18 touchdowns.
That's a mammoth.
Yeah. And obviously Cameron Brait being a big red zone target kind of limits that. But still, I think there's total room for growth. And he's not just a fucking possession receiver or a jump ball kind of guy. His average depth of target was 16 yards. And that was second only behind DeSean Jackson. Well, with receivers who had 75 targets and more. But his average depth of target was only behind DeSean Jackson. Which is crazy because DeSean Jackson, obviously, all he does is get fucking 50-yard bombs from fucking Captain Kirk over there. Now, Evans is not a guy you think of to get balls like that.
No.
But you combine that with him being the number one focal point of that offense and him getting more red zone targets, I think, you know.
Sky's the limit.
This time next year, we could be looking at Mike Evans as a top three, top
five. We really could. And getting him at 8,
can't be. I think it's a good value. So, him is your wide receiver one. God bless.
Sign on the dotted line.
Yeah. Sitting back thinking about this, I think it's a no-brainer for McCoy.
Yeah.
You and me were both really high on McCoy going into last year.
Yeah, I don't know why.
Especially for his value.
There weren't many others.
We got a lot. On the fucking mock draft we did last year, I picked him in like the second round, like early second round-ish. Yeah. And he was going in mock drafts in like the third round-ish.
I got him the third pick of the third round in our draft, and he was the best
people
player on my team.
Why the fuck you taking him so high? Because he's a clear-cut fucking workhorse, and he's one of the most talented backs in the entire NFL.
Fucking idiots.
Yeah, so anyone who... Whatever. I'm not even going to yell at y'all because I love y'all. But let me get into McCoy for a hot minute. Now, he finished as RB4 in fantasy. He had the highest yards per carry for any qualified running back. So anyone over 130 or 131 carries, which would qualify as like a normal fucking running back, he had the highest yards per carry. So he was the most efficient back, basically. Now, it was also the highest yards per carry of his career. Now, the same kind of deal goes with him as Mike Evans when it comes to the touchdown ceiling.
Oh.
If you had McCoy, you knew how fucking frustrating it was to see the Buffalo Bills in the red zone on that 1 yard line. Because what would
McCoy
happen,
gets them there?
What would happen?
And then Mr. Vulture himself, Mike Gillisley, comes and runs the ball in every time.
Mike Gillisley had fucking 9 touchdowns this year.
9.
How many backup running backs will have 9 touchdowns besides like a Patriots running back?
The Giants backup running backs had like 1 combined.
Yeah. Shady still finished with 14 total touchdowns.
It's incredible, but just think about how many more he could have had.
Yeah, he could have had a fucking monster year if they gave him the ball more on the goal line. So that...
And that's a recurring theme, because that happened in Philly, too. So, yeah. So don't think some magical thing is going to happen. Just know he's not getting those goal line carries.
Yeah, and also Tyrod had 6 rushing touchdowns.
He did.
So that's a total of 15... That's a total of 15.
And Tyrod might not even be back. So exactly. That's so another thing you have to monitor.
Could hurt him, though. Rex Ryan is out. So
good for you, Bills fans.
Yeah, in terms of an offensive mind, it doesn't get any worse than that. So, I mean, I don't know. I don't know if it's going to get worse. I don't know if it's going to get better there. But, you know, I think the thing that kind of scares people away from McCoy, would you agree with this? Like, how come McCoy wouldn't be going in the top 4 with those other guys? Do you think it's because he has the same kind of reputation as Julio? It's because he has that, like, probable or questionable tag every week? Is that why you think he drops this far?
I think that is why, because I've had him, 5 years in a row now?
Yeah.
And it drives me crazy. If I had probable, questionable, doubtful, you just never know. It's every friggin' week.
Yeah. You don't question his talent.
Yeah. You know,
you don't question his workload. I'm just trying to ask.
Talent-wise, but he's always got that injury bug question mark next to him. And guys who pick in the top 4 want to make sure they're picking
the workhorse,
studs, the workhorse, the healthy workhorse that you know you can count 16 games on.
Yeah, so I think that's really the only pitfall there. And it's not like, I don't know, he hasn't missed a significant portion of games. It's just annoying having that guy who's always questionable and always, you know, whatever. So if you take McCoy, obviously have his backup.
Just be weary. Yeah.
He's one of those guys you do want to handcuff because he's more injury prone than other guys. He has a lot of those soft tissue injuries.
Yeah.
So that wraps up number 9.
Yeah.
Double digits, baby.
Number 10, otherwise known as Eli Manning, I'm taking AJ Green. Now, if he wasn't hurt, obviously there's an argument to be made that Green is in the same class as Julio, Odell, and Jordy, and Antonio Brown. Well, maybe not Antonio Brown, but...
Maybe you need to slow your roll.
Sorry.
Butter this kid up.
He was number 6 fantasy wide receiver on a points per game basis. He was number 2 behind Brown, that's why I had him in my head. In PPR, if you don't count the game he left with 0 catches in week 11. Out of the 9 games he played in, he had over 165 receiving yards in 3 of them, and so 1 out of every 3 games. And without an upgrade to their offense, I'd expect most of it to run through him again, as usual. And Dalton is a capable quarterback who feeds in A.J. Green. Finished with 99 targets in 9 games. So over a 16-game span, that's going to equivalent 176. And that would have led the entire NFL. At 10, rounding out the first round, A.J. Green. I mean, I'm not his biggest fan. I know he likes him, but...
I think
with those stats in a full 16 games.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at it, it wasn't like he had a bad year.
No, I know. It's just something personal.
I don't know why.
Well, maybe he fucked me a couple years ago. Could have been a game.
Fuck that. His fucking left tackle.
Don't let my grudge affect your drafting. The guy's a stud, and when he's healthy, and him and Dalton are clicking, they're one of the best combos in the game. And he's right up there with those guys we mentioned before. So at 10, wide receiver 6 on this draft board.
Yeah, exactly. I think he's going to be very overlooked next year just because of the injury, and they're not going to look at, you know, the numbers he put up in those 9 games. We keep discounting that last game because he left the game with the injury. He had 0 catches, so that will bring all of his averages down, obviously. So the target number, he would have led the NFL if you put it over a 16-game span. And,
You know,
the ceiling is there. It's the same argument that you would make last year coming into the draft as you would make this year. So people are taking him, what was he taking, number 5 or 6 in the draft?
4 or 5.
I think
Hopkins went 4 and he went 5.
Yeah, so AJ Green is picking 5 or 6, and I think the exact same argument you have this year. And you know,
fantasy owners have a short-term memory problem too. Like, they'll look back and say, "Oh wow, he missed the last 6 games." But as we said, if you equivalate the targets he had through the 9 games and you go to 16, he leads the NFL.
So he's going to finish his top three if he does.
And with his talent, he's going to put up numbers. He has done it before and he'll do it again as long as he stays healthy. Him and Dalton. Money. And Dalton's got great hair, so obviously he's got good arm.
I'm going to get into number 11. We're still deciding if we want to do 10 or 12, but I'm going to get into 11 because it's another one of my fucking boys. Devonta Freeman. Now, he's going to be questionable to a lot of you guys. Mm-hmm. I know you guys don't, you know, when you hear the split backfield, when you have
alarms.
Yeah, exactly. The alarms go off, but I think it's just we need to adapt to how the NFL is being played now, man.
Yeah.
Even with Tevin Coleman there, Freeman's still the number 1. And if you watched any of his games this year, you know that he's legit. In terms of talent, dude, his cuts are unbelievable. He's strong for his size. He's super quick and agile. And he's a great receiver. This is back-to-back years of top 6 running back finishes. So, you know, he's done it consistently now. After, obviously, that RB1 finish in 2015 that put him on the map. But yeah, Coleman's still going to see a lot of work, obviously.
As he should.
Yeah, but even with Coleman playing last year and getting the work that he got, Freeman still got 15-plus touches in every single game except one. You give me a question for you. Would you rather have Freeman in that Atlanta offense getting 15 touches or someone like Lamar Miller in a shitty offense getting 20 touches?
It's not even a question. I want Devonta Freeman.
You want Freeman, right?
100 times out of 100 times.
Exactly. So it's not always just about the volume. Some players need volume to produce, and that usually doesn't last for the full length of the season, as you saw this year with Lamar Miller. He was in and out, inconsistent. But with a guy like Freeman, you know, he could burst out at any time. You saw those 3 touchdown games. You know, he makes plays with his feet. He makes plays with his eyes. And, you know, I think a guy like him, a talent like that, is something that you can't just pass over and you know, kind of just go by. So he has, what other kind of stats I got here? Back-to-back 1,500-yard seasons, 13-plus touchdowns, in the most explosive offense in the NFL, and that offensive line is only getting better. It's probably top 5 right now.
Yeah, Alex Mack, what a signing.
Exactly, dude. Unbelievable. Him and Jake Matthews coming together. stud duo. So I think Freeman, I love Freeman next year, man.
I do too. Him. And I was guilty of sin going into last year. I was like, one year wonder, whatever.
Yeah, now
guy's got serious talent. Back to back years. Yeah. I'm so sold. I'll take him at 11 any day.
Yeah, that 10-11 turn, if you can get like two studs
that's
there,
nice.
Freeman is one. Yeah, I like
you,
that.
You go Green and Freeman as your 1-2 combo.
Yeah, I think you.
You'd be happy.
You have
based on our
ceiling there. Yeah. Who are you taking number 12?
I'm gonna take DeMarco Murray. Guy I used to hate as he played for my division rival. But he's a guy that likely got into the playoffs last year. He was running back 19 off the board, correct?
Yeah.
Last year, something like that?
Pick 19. 18 running backs went before DeMarco Murray.
That's pathetic because he finished as a top 5 running back. Now, I know many people probably didn't see it coming. Question marks surrounding DeMarco Murray came into the year. Some questions were his effectiveness. He had a poor year the year before. The offense as a whole having to play from behind. And rookie stud Derrick Henry taking some of his touches away.
Yeah, how many fucking articles were written about how Derrick Henry was going to be the workhorse by the end of the year?
And that was not the case at all. Yeah. A surprisingly,
DeMarco, man, fucking
hats off
to
you, DeMarco. Yeah, for real. You got out of that trash bag Philly, and you went to Tennessee. Good for you. He flipped the bird at all three of those question marks coming into the season, and he grabbed his junk on his way to producing a 1,600-yard season with 12 touchdowns. Yeah, 1,600 yards after doing shit last year. Sorry, confused me for a second, too. He would have been fantasy running back, too, in 2015. He averaged almost 22 touches a game. If you're giving DeMarco Murray 22 touches a game, good things are going to happen. He's turning 29 in February, so he's still got a couple good years of effectiveness. I love Marcus Mariota. I love that Titans team. I think if they can add a guy on the outside, I was just talking about.
Do you know, have you seen any updates on the Mariota injury?
I have not.
I'm not even
sure. I didn't even.
I'm going to look that up. Why does it keep going like dark and
I don't know.
You see that, right?
Yeah.
I hope that's not going to come up in the video. Whatever.
No, it looks cool. Yeah, fuck the video. I hope Marcus isn't hurt badly.
Yeah, we got to check that injury. Because, I mean, if Marcus Mariota was missing any time in the season, which I guess it'll be like, what, eight months? Or not even. Like
no,
6 months.
No.
He completely tore his shit up, right?
Oh, yeah. He's fucked. Wow.
We totally might have fucked up this pick.
Yeah.
We require the assistance of a knee walker scooter for the next 2 months. Mariota could miss the entire offseason program, but barring a setback, will be ready for training camp.
He's good.
DeMarco's
he's good.
Fine.
DeMarco's fine. That box won't be stacked too much. He's
4 to 5 month recovery.
He's good. He's fine. I hope so for them because I like the Titans.
Yeah, so
there's no worries about Murray going into next season. He's going to do the same thing.
Yeah, so he had 22 touches a game. Henry still averaged 9 touches a game.
Yeah, like Henry gets a few more touches.
Yeah,
but
I still don't think that's going to kill the guy.
No, DeMarco's going to see his fair share, and the guy ran like a bull.
Yeah, and the thing about that is even if Henry gets more carries, Murray out-targeted Henry 67 to 15. So Murray's clearly like the pass catching back there. So, you know, even if that number dips, he's still going to be seeing 18 to 20 touches, and, you know, that's... that's great for
one way or the other, yeah.
for your running back, you know. So that's going to round out our top 12 for a half point PPR mock draft, first round only for 2017. And we're gonna get into some honorable mentions because obviously there's a lot of guys that had good years that can make the case for being, you know, there's a couple guys on that list that I would choose that I could see someone choosing over DeMarco at the end.
J.H.I. is one of those guys.
J.H.I. He turned into that workhorse in Miami.
Yep. Jordan Howard
was well, fucking, yeah, he was, I think he, over those last, he took over as the workhorse like in week 4,
yeah,
and he might have been, I'm not, I haven't even looked at the numbers.
He finished second in rushing yards.
Yeah, which is incredible.
Incredible.
Let me pull up some stizzats for your asses. Okay, so Jordan Howard took over in week 4 as the workhorse, basically, and from week 4 to the end of the season, Jordan Howard was running back number 6 in standard, ahead of DeMarco Murray, and he was running back number 7 in PPR, which is one behind Murray, but still 6-7. Jordan Howard making a legit case to be
an
early pick, and the offense definitely scares me. And the
offense is abysmal. Your quarterback situation is still up for grabs. You don't know if Jeffrey's coming back.
Yeah, that could be a bad situation. That could be something I might avoid. Obviously, there's so much time left between now and the beginning of the season.
Yeah, something's going to happen. But like we said, this is our very early.
Very, very, very,
first
very, very,
draft.
Yeah, we'll probably do more throughout the offseason. Maybe one after, you know, when the summer starts, and then one like right around draft time or some shit.
Yeah.
Then you have guys like what are your thoughts on like Gronkowski, like
no.
tight ends?
No.
Like, this is why people preach that you don't take the tight end, because now you're just like kind of fucked. If you took Gronk last year in the first round or something, you know, like you're
like
you're
good old Charlie Julie 2 years in a row.
Great guy.
Yeah, great guy, great friend.
Not a great drafter.
Not very well.
So,
but I'm staying very far away from Gronkowski and tight ends.
Where would you be okay taking Gronk next year? Back end of round two?
Yeah, I'm not taking him anywhere near the first or
early second.
Early to middle second.
Yeah, I think if I'm
late second, early third, that's
what I'm thinking.
I can't trust him at all. But
I think if he
he's
lands,
a singular talent.
I think if he comes into the season with the reports that he's full. Also, remember coming into the last fucking season reports were fully healthy. He missed like what the first 3 weeks.
Yeah, Sam Watkins is another example.
Yeah, exactly. So it's those are things you have to monitor very closely. But if Gronk's at full health, getting him in the third round could be a league winning pick.
Yeah,
you know,
it could, because
so.
He's a singular talent and.
Yeah. So there's guys like, you know, Jay Ajayi, Jordan Howard, Gronk, Travis Kelce is making
great
a case.
Year. He had
also,
a quietly great year, too. I didn't realize how great a year he had.
Yeah, he wound up as tight end one. I mean, don't know if that would have happened if Jordan Reed and Gronk were
fully
healthy.
I doubt it, but
still
gotta
a
give
major
props.
Breakout for him in that offense. And then T.Y. Well, I would never take him in the first round
because
he kind of scares me as a receiver. But I think something that's super just underestimated as a whole, look at the wide receivers, the top wide receivers. You know, the Antonio Browns, the Odells, the Julios, they all have very, 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 very good quarterbacks throwing to them. And I think last year, something that, you know, you could learn from and take from, my ass especially, is don't underestimate the quarterback that's throwing that wide receiver the ball.
Yeah.
Look at the wide receivers, the top guys going in the first, second round that busted out. Fucking Allen Robinson, Brandon Marshall, Sammy Watkins, all guys with shitty quarterbacks throwing to them. And then look at the top guys, all have elite quarterbacks throwing to them. So I
Eli
think that's something.
Throws to it down.
Yeah, anti-Eli over here. But I think that's something you just need to not underestimate.
And he's got like he always scared me too because I always just looked at T.Y. like boomer bust, but
he wasn't. He was super.
He
consistent.
Was really, really consistent this year. And if that Colts team fixed that offensive line, Andrew Luck has decent time to throw the ball.
They do have a bunch of steps before they move up. You know, they're gonna have to get a new running back.
Sad as it is to say, Frank, thank you for being solid again. Man.
Yeah, Frank the Tank.
Holy
man.
Smokes!
It's a fucking gift that never stops giving.
He was.
T.Y. and obviously Moncrief will be back next year, so that's another thing to look out for. I don't know. I like T.Y., but I probably wouldn't reach any earlier than end of... he's going to keep going. I feel like he's going to keep getting picked in the same spot year after year just because people don't like that. I can't even say they don't like the prototypical wide receiver because you have Odell and Antonio, but I just don't think we ever see T.Y. kind of enter that realm of the smaller receiver that... you know, becomes an elite talent.
Yeah.
Like we would have seen it by now. Most of that is raw talent.
You would think, exactly.
So.
But looking at his stats, man, he was as consistent as it gets. He wasn't boom or bust. I mean, sure, he had a few clunkers, but.
Yeah, he had a couple bad games. Well, you know, I was actually, one of the podcasts I was listening to, it was saying how when he went against good defenses, those are when he had bad games, which is a big cause for concern, because that was like Allen Robinson last year. Yeah, look at Vikings, 45
Chiefs.
Yards. Chiefs, 20 yards. Texans,
Broncos,
49.
41.
Broncos, 41. Yeah, so his
that is a concern.
His bad games are against, you know, the better defenses.
He lit up the Bears. He went 10 for 171 in a touchdown.
Yeah, so he lit up shitty defenses. It was not as good against good defenses.
So
who do they have in their division? They have Jaguars.
They have Texans, Jaguars, and Titans.
That's tough.
That's tough.
Well, the Titans, not so much, but when you think of the Jaguars,
Jalen
Ramsey is going to be fucking matching up with him for years to come. Texans always have a solid pass D.
Always.
So that's tough matchups right there. But, I mean, you know.
Still puts up numbers.
These are just random fucking stats and stuff we're throwing at you right now, obviously, super early. But that
that's
is
why
our top
honorable level. Mentions.
Honorable mentions. Don't get angry at us. Jesus Christ, relax. It's all going to be okay. Fantasy season. Super
can't come
far
soon
away.
Enough. I can't wait to be in that draft board.
Oh my god, I know.
The Knicks are gonna win a world title before we draft.
Jeez.
Gotta trust that process.
Alright. Well, that's gonna wrap up. That's gonna conclude our video. If you enjoyed,
Send me a nude. I'm just kidding. Thumbs up the picture, the fucking picture, the video. Share it with your friends, motherfucker. If y'all trying to lose a league, go share this shit. Subscribe to the channel if you already or not. And that's all we got to say. Everything else will be linked in the description.
Be back for round two soon.
Yeah, trigger.